My name is Sara Cardona. I was born in Mexico City, and I moved to Texas with my parents, who were they're artists, and they were part of the counterculture. They were part of what's called the hippiteco movement. They were children of the 60s, and that had a big influence on my work in different ways. Being part of the 2016 Cinco Latinas, a Common Thread show, was really important because I went through a transition as many female artists, being a parent, and I had gotten divorced, and I had a kind of a hiatus from making work between 2010 and 2016. So it was a very sort of tumultuous time in my life. But when you lapse for some time, it's like anything, it's hard to find the motivation or the energy to restart. It made me feel validated and like what I had gone through was important and that I was on the right track. So it was very important that way as an artist. What it helped me do was to have some exposure again. I have some pieces in Mérida in Mexico, so this is the first time I'm actually getting to exhibit in Mexico, which is, you know, where I'm from originally, so it's a really nice feeling to be able to be there. And that's in a group show. That's going to be this fall in October. And then I recently had a studio visit from one of the curators from the Museum of Art in San Antonio, and she saw my work in a show last year there, so I'll be part of a group show of Texas female abstract artists, and that opens in March of 2020. In many sort of categories that are traditionally marginalized, whether it's being a woman and then also being a Latina woman, being an artist, you know, being a mother or having families, I mean, not that all women do, but that's often the experience of many people. I feel like it's important that we always first and foremost do the work that we want to do. This is something that I've gone through as a personal journey, that the work be sincere and honest and really come from, you know, from who you are rather than from a perspective of having people impose identity structure on you, like your work has to be about being a woman or has to be about being a Latina. I really like collage because it suits my my needs as an artist. I feel like I'm more free when I'm not completely generating the image. I do generate it, but I think of myself more almost like a film editor. So I look for things that interest me, and I try to do that very instinctually. So not pre-think things out, but look for material that interests me. And I some days I just cut and almost like accumulate material, and then other days I, you know, move things around, and it's very meditative. It's a process that also, honestly, I came to because I was struggling as a parent, and I think that's, you know, reality. It's like sometimes I couldn't, you know, put the same sort of continuity or energy into painting because I'd stop for 4 days and come back and not know where to pick up. And whereas with collage, I feel very gratified. I can do one type of work, and if that's all I can do, that's okay. As I gain sort of skill and structure, now I've kind of been thinking more about content. And while I do sort of gravitate towards, you know, specific things, putting them together in a way that has a whole, as a whole, is a body of work. The body of work has changed. Working now with trying to figure out how to break out of the square and out of the frame. And so now moving into paper as sculpture, which is new for me because I wasn't a sculptor before. But so I'm taking collages, and I still sort of build them the same way, but then I'm photographing them and scanning them larger onto bigger pieces of paper and cutting those out and making malleable wall relief kinds of sculptures. So that's a huge transition for me because I'm thinking of paper now three-dimensionally instead of flat. There's a series that I'm working on with fabrics that are specifically about blankets, and the blanket itself has order, and what's interesting is it's a very free-flowing fabric, so depending on, you know, how I work with the pieces, they lend themselves to feeling like movement and motion, which is something I'm very interested in, how to make something flat feel like it's got movement or like it's almost like a film still. But structurally, the blanket, the way they're made, and textiles, is on a grid. So something about that is informing how I work with them. And then I've been very interested in blankets because I didn't grow up on the border, and right now we have a lot of issues about migration and the border, and you asked me about being a Latina, and while I never thought of myself as making work that's overtly political, I have been thinking about my own journey and how I, you know, moved back and forth quite a bit when I was a child. And to me, the blanket is sort of when you reduce a house to just the few things that you can take, has a long history of being a transport system. So I'm interested in bandanas for that reason. You know, there's a classic where you throw your stuff in a bandana. But it's also something that's very practical. People cover their mouths with it when, you know, you're walking and there's dust. Blankets have, especially the blanket in Mexico, you know, it's the sarape that men traditionally wore, the old saltillo ones, is really just like almost carrying your home, like a shell, because it keeps you warm, you can sleep on it. And then of course it also has become a kind of a kitsch commodity, right? Like people go to Mexico and they buy Mexican blankets. And so there's all these other associations with, you know, Americans who go and buy Mexican blankets and these things that travel back and forth. And that's very interesting to me, this idea of one object that has a lot of association with movement across the border. So maybe I'm not dealing with people, with bodies, but indirectly textiles are the extension of the body. There is definitely a thematic connection between the work that I did in the first show, the Cinco Latinas, the first Common Thread, which is a really beautiful title because it is weaving us together, but the work I did for that show. I was very interested in migration, and I still am, but I'm also interested in working with abstract forms because I think with figures, they become politically charged very quickly, you know, the minute you introduce a human body. So I've been very interested in how I can deal with issues about people migrating without showing the body, but showing the things that are left behind. And so in that first show, I had done a piece that was about the ocean and all the migrants who have come from North Africa and have landed on the Isle of Lesbos in Greece, and then also in France and Calais. And you look at migrant camps and there's always these, like, you know, clothes left over, blankets, backpacks, you know, sleeping bags, because people are moving fast. And there are these sort of strange things that are like detritus that wash up on the beach. So I had done some pieces that were very fluid because I was thinking about the ocean. These pieces, they're radial, and I almost think of it as a web, and I also think about the circularity between the United States and Mexico. And there isn't really a clear place of origin and a clear place of an endpoint because things keep going back. And I think it's very easy to talk about the migrants who are come here for necessity. But as a person who goes back, I also see, and it's less discussed, the migration of a lot of Americans who go and live in Mexico, the kind of back and forth between commerce, how like, you know, Oaxaca and mezcal has become very popular, and there's this huge sort of retaking of a lot of things that are Mexican, and they enter into popular culture in the United States. And so I'm kind of, in a way, dealing less just strictly with humans, but thinking about commerce and capital and objects. So that's why I've started to, this one is one of the few. I have another one with some tires where I've introduced some elements that are more clearly like cultural, you know, pop culture references, because I'm exploring that idea in this piece. You know, this one is called Black Market. So I'm thinking about markets like as a system that goes around and around. It's like a pinwheel, but it's also a vanishing point, like a black hole. And in this one, I was very specifically thinking about drug culture and this kind of idea of, you know, the rhetoric of like drugs come from Mexico, and then, you know, we have the consumer culture here. So all the sort of things, you know, these Baja hoodies that are really, the fabric is called a jerga, and they were very working class kind of fabrics. And, you know, in the 70s and 80s, it was sort of this kind of image of whoever sells you your bag of weed or something is wearing these like Mexican clothing. So there's this kind of way in which, just like hoodies get charged in terms of being part of African American rhetoric about black young men, I think there's all this sort of ideas that are around, you know, like Mexican bad guys, and it's like, you know, they're associated with a lower economic status, whether it's, you know, workers wearing the bandanas or the, you know, Baja hoodies or whatever. So that's sort of all in there. But then formally, which is why I said, I think as an artist, you also have to be true to your kind of formal interests. I'm trying to explore a different way of working rather than just a sort of fluid way, where it's a little more structured, as you were saying. So. I just need to respond to the world. I just realized that there's, for me, a very strong mind-body connection, and I need to channel that into physical things. But I really like the tactile qualities and working with things physically. If I go a long period of time without making something, I don't feel good. I feel agitated because I feel like it's almost like something gets, you know, welled up inside or blocked up inside. And especially the more that I'm thinking and making, when I'm making things, it, I don't know how to express this, but it makes me more aware of the world. And so it's actually, strangely, the habit of doing things all the time that puts me emotionally out into the universe and makes me feel really present. And so I think it's almost out of necessity. There are a lot of artists, but not very many Latinas doing abstract art. So I started really looking into it, and I really think that is because there's a long tradition of like figurative work, you know, in Mexican art, but also women have been excluded, in at least in Mexican culture somewhat, from abstraction. And I'm not really sure why that is, because then I was looking at art from Mexico, and all the great Mexican female artists, they all do figurative work. It's like abstraction is the domain of men. And even though there's a long tradition of design, like in Mexico City, there's a lot of strong design and graphic things and stuff, not that many women doing it. And because I thought surely she was joking. And since it's about abstraction, the show, she was like, I looked and looked and looked and, you know, couldn't find anybody. And I thought, wow, that's a really interesting, that's another kind of a strain. It's just not a statistic, but, you know, a peculiar thing about how what happens with gender. Like, I don't know if abstraction is just something that's been associated with the cerebral or the, do you know what I mean? Like more math and sciences. And I'm not sure. I really don't know, but you know, I've been looking. There are some Jewish women who do it, and I think it's because there's a tradition in Arab and Islamic and Judaic culture where you don't represent the body as much. And so, you know, there's like Rothenberg and like, you know, all these women who come out of like an American Jewish tradition, but not in Mexico. Well, and I just did a talk about the connection between Mexican and Texas artists. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Octavio Medellin, who was here, he trained some of, there's one woman who did sculptures for the Fair Park, you know, the Centennial. Mm-hmm. She was one of the few artists that came out of his, but she was the only one. And of course they're figurative, but you know, there's just not that long of a tradition. There are still very like male dominated fields, you know, cinema too. Like if we don't have curators and people who are in charge of making decisions about what gets shown, and which is what you're saying, is like it takes a curator to curate other women. It's the same with art schools. If all the art schools are male and, you know, they project their preferences, and you have men training other men, you have less men training women. And I don't know what that is, if there's, you know, those old things of like the physicality of the work or whatever. There's two things going on. Sometimes it's because they're allegorical. They're not really depicting women. It's just that the state is female, or that Texas is female. You see them? So at that point, then it's they're abstractions of interpretation. But then the other thing is, in Mexico, they are very deliberately going back to indigenismo. So they're looking at all the massive Aztec sculptures, the Mayan sculptures, which, even though they're very imperial cultures, the whole base is agricultural and female in that regard. So, I mean, Huatlicue is not pretty. She's really scary and massive. And I think they were like, you know, carving things out of like volcanic rock and making all those kind of connections with that tradition. So that's why they're like that. You know, in regards to my background, I often feel that I'm like a lot of people who are bicultural, in the sense that my earliest foundation was growing up in Mexico. I moved back and forth so much. When I was young, I actually used to stutter because my mind could not switch gears fast enough in terms of language, and it was. One of the reasons I made art was because I wasn't in a place long enough to make a lot of friends. I would make friends, and then of course I would have to move. And I lived in San Francisco and in Boston and in Austin and then in Mexico City. And then my mom, at one point, you know, separated from my dad, and we went to stay with my grandparents in Oaxaca, which they don't even speak Spanish there. It's just, there was a lot of upheaval in my life. But at the same time, I think that marked me personally as a person who's really feels bicultural, and Mexico is very important to me, in the sense that it was my earliest experiences, and I really think we have to be even careful about when I talk about Mexico, I'm talking about a very specific Mexico, because that's not the same as growing up in northern Mexico, or, you know, there's to me, Texas is Mexico too. But it's a different reality. And then there's issues of the fact that I grew up in what I call a cultural class. I don't know, we didn't come from a wealthy family, but because my parents were artists, they, you know, had a lot of friends who had access or enjoyed access to things that normally, you know, someone else might not have. And so I feel like that is what is really part of my identity. And you know, my dad is from here, from the United States, and so I look more like him, you know, and the only time that people have ever told me I don't look Mexican is actually in the United States. When I'm there, no one ever, you know, brings those questions up about identity. So I think it's all kind of packed inside, and maybe over the years I've thought a lot about perceptions of either country and the other country. So, you know, how the United States, I'm very aware of that because I go back and forth so much that I see how the United States is represented and how people relate to it within Mexico. And then I have the same experience here. And so that kind of keeps me in two spaces at once, which I think, you know, is truthfully a different experience than if you're Mexican-American and you've grown up all your life, especially for older generations, kind of occulting, you know, the side of your family that is more Latino. And that's because there's been so much racism and oppression. And so, you know, I'm aware of the things that come easily for me because I didn't entirely grow up, you know, in the United States under those conditions. But maybe that makes me feel more sensitive to things, and like I have a, not always in my art, but I feel like I have a social responsibility to use that advantage that I've had to support my community. I'm interested in also how things are interconnected, maybe because I have traveled and experienced a lot of different realities back and forth. I you know, find connections, and Vasconcelos said this, that Mexico is really a crossroads of many things. And, you know, when my son, whose father was from Bangladesh, when he was born, and we went to visit his family several times, I couldn't help, and I'm sure this is true for anyone who travels, you start to see connections between, you know, cultures, and that opens your mind, you know, to so many things, like, you know, the most classic Mexican image is the, they call it China Poblana, and really it was this woman who came with the Portuguese in the 1700s, and she was from India. She wasn't Chinese, but, you know, the Spanish called everybody who was from the Asian subcontinent, you know, Oriental. That was their way of saying, they would say, "Ah, it's China." And she brought, she was probably from the region of Rajasthan, and she had this full skirt with the sequins and our little glass mirrors and, you know, the wrap. And that, she was so enchanting to this very small community in Puebla that became copied and became this very, very typical Mexican dress. And I feel like the beauty of all of our cultures, and that's what's the strength of this country, is that it's a continuous renewal. You can find things, you know, that are universally connected, and I try to do that with my own work. So the less I limit myself in terms of my idea of identity, the more authentic and sincere I can be, the more interconnected I can you know, create. And so when you asked me originally this question about how the works relate, maybe that is why I felt sort of a connection to migrants coming from North Africa and India and Pakistan. It's that I see the same parallels with them that, you know, people from Mexico are experiencing now. So intuitively, what I can say is right now what interests me is figuring out how I can move a little more into sculptural pieces to move away from the flatness and animate them somehow. Maybe even actual movement, I don't know. It could be animation, I'm not really sure, but I feel like that's one thing that's become very important to me, is that they keep evolving to feel free. In part, I get feedback from people, and sometimes feedback is, you know, of course, very positive and great, and sometimes people say things, and indirectly they might say something, and it actually kind of stings because you realize that wasn't what you intended. And I think that happens to all artists. You go through these waves where you become so familiar with what you're doing that you're not surprising yourself anymore, and sometimes that can telescope out to people. So I was getting very positive feedback, but I realized some of it was about the formal qualities, and, you know, and inside that kind of like was like a ding ding ding, like a bell, where I realized, like, I need to break out of this kind of formal, you know, square because the language of it is too much like what people expect out of abstract work. And so that's what led me to really struggle a little bit to figure out how I can start cutting these up and making them more free.